My name is Fred Pollock. I'm the Chief Investment Officer at GCM Grosvenor, and I manage the Pengana PE1 Trust. Private equity enhances the risk-return attributes of individuals' portfolios, and they don't own enough of it. We see everything in the private equity ecosystem and create the most diversified portfolio available to individual investors.
Hello, I'm Hans Lee from Livewire Markets, and it's good to be with you for the latest interview in the Livewire Listed series. Today, we get to introduce you to the Pengana Private Equity Trust, that is ticker code PE1 on the ASX. It's actually only one of three publicly listed private equity strategies in Australia, and since inception, it's returned something like 11.5% per annum on average. And today, just for you, we get the privilege of speaking to the man who actually runs the money. His name is Fred Pollock, and he's the head of the GCM Strategic Investments Group and, of course, the portfolio manager for the Pengana Private Equity Trust. And he joins us now via Zoom from Chicago. Fred, welcome. It's great to see you.
Thank you. Thank you for having me, Hans.
Why don't we just start a really big picture here? What role does private equity play in an average investor's portfolio, and what role should it play?
If you look at the average individual's portfolio, though, meaning the average kind of retail investor or average individual out in the world, it's much, much lower, meaning closer to zero in most portfolios. And there's many, many, many groups of people who really don't have any exposure to private equity outside of maybe their own personal lives, where they own a business or they have some other exposure to a private equity type enterprise, but not as a real investment asset class. The way I like to think about it, the private equity market is far larger than the public equity market. So if you look to just sheer number of companies or size of companies, dollar value of total investable assets, it's a lot like the bond market in that it dwarfs the public and listed equity market. So we all open the newspaper and all we really talk about, we talk about stocks because it's kind of exciting and it's what everybody knows and it's what everyone sees. But the reality is, one of the biggest investable asset classes is private equity. I think it should be a big part of their portfolio. If you looked at something like an Efficient Frontier, it would obviously tell you because of the returns available that it should be a part of your portfolio. And then, the interesting question, if you look at a lot of math, it'll tell you that people should have kind of almost close to half of their equity invested in private equity and the other half kind of invested in public equities. Typically, most people are not even close to that. So, I mean, it's really not even a question of kind of optimizing at the margin. Really, most people are just starting, in terms of including it in their portfolio. They just need more. It's kind of the common answer for at least individuals across the board.
So you've already spoken there about some of the roles that perhaps it should play. What benefits are there, or have you noticed, to offering this type of a fund actually as a listed product?
There's challenges to it, and then there's also kind of opportunities from it. The challenge actually was we wanted to make sure we deliver an institutional quality offering. And what that really means is you need to be able to invest for incredibly long periods of time in private equity. So private equity isn't the type of thing where you can build up a program or invest in companies and exit and enter every year, every 2 years, every 3 years. You really need to do a really good job. You need a kind of 10 to 20 year program, and you need to build it up in a diversified manner. And you need to be investing every year to make sure you kind of average out the time periods, which some will be good, some will be bad for deploying capital. You have to do all these types of things. But then there's features from an opportunity perspective of a listed product that are great, which is, if you could do all that and you could wrap it in a fund and then you could fractionalize it and allow people to kind of accommodate their own needs in terms of position size, where they could trade in and out with other individuals in the secondary market, then you could kind of have the best of both worlds, which is you manage the underlying capital from a private equity perspective in a long-term frame, but you allow individuals the flexibility to kind of go on market and buy shares, add additional shares in their portfolio, cut the sizing in their portfolio, which at least from the experience I've had talking to a lot of the investors, particularly in Australia, that part of the feature set is essential to them being able to manage their plan.
There's not just one private equity product, obviously. There's lots of private equity products out there. How does your investment strategy and your process separate you from the competition?
In a funny way, I think the reason why we're good at what we do is we're really not competitive. And what do I mean by that? I like to think of Grosvenor as a partner of choice for all of the world's best in class private equity managers. And so, at any moment in time, we've probably got relationships economically, either we're investing in their funds on behalf of clients, we're doing deals with them, that might be 300, 400, 500 different fund houses and funds. And we leverage those relationships to find deal flow. We leverage those relationships to inform our own investment activity, and then we kind of activate it. So I actually think we're more of a solutions provider or an open architecture kind of solutions provider for investors where, you know, we manufacture some of these things. We're happy to do investments ourselves, but we also partner with a lot of the world's best private equity shops to get deals done. So if you looked at kind of the, you know, the Pengana PE1 trust at any moment in time, you'd see there's literally hundreds of world-class sponsors who are really a part of delivering that economic solution for the clients. And we're kind of proud of that, but that's what we do. We think of ourselves as kind of a partner and a facilitator rather than a competitor in kind of the private equity ecosystem.
Well, I'm glad you highlighted there about the number of businesses and relationships that you have, because I did note that there are something like 550 entities in this particular fund. What is the rationale behind investing in so many entities?
If you looked at private equity today, there's probably 5,000 or 6,000 institutional quality private equity firms. You know, it's a very large number. And there's more than 10,000 private equity firms, but there's probably half of those that you think of as the kind of institutional eligible for investment. You know, we're with kind of roughly 10% of those, if you looked across the board. And really what that comes down to is making sure that you're diversified across all the different styles of investment, all the different sectors and areas of activity. Also, the size of company, meaning we tend to target middle market companies, kind of smaller, less efficient situations, rather than very, very large funds with very, very large companies. So there's a lot of reasons why you would target one niche or another. But the real underlying truth is the private equity world has become ever more specialized, a little bit like the public markets, right? So if you went to your average public market investor today trying to produce alpha, it's unlikely you're going to find somebody who just invests in everything and they know everything. You know, they have sector expertise, they have knowledge around a specific company. When you get into the private equity context, that becomes even more true.
Now, as you've pointed out already, private equity is sought after as an investment vehicle, but it's also often criticized as something that's too opaque or an asset class that simply just does not have enough information about what's underneath the hood. How would you respond to a potential investor with those kinds of concerns?
To be honest, I think it's a lot of our clients have the same grievances, right, in terms of what they're doing. And I think we view ourselves as kind of a value-added intermediary in that private equity system for that reason, which is we have a team of, you know, over 50 people who work on all our co-investment transactions, for example. And so, you know, we're doing an extra level of work that in many cases, you know, could be even more work than the underlying sponsor is doing around a transaction. Or, you know, we're doing a compare across different areas and sectors in a way that maybe other people are not necessarily doing. So I actually view part of our job is to make sure that our clients have access to everything. They see everything going on in the private equity universe, because a lot of it's like hard to know, right? If you said, you know, there's 5,000 or 10,000 private firms, how could you possibly know them all or know what they're doing or even have a kind of a knowledge base to even decide which ones you want to work with? And then once you've decided to work with them, how do you know which deals they're doing that you want to work on and put your capital to work on those individual deals? You know, I view that as kind of part of what we do. And it's part of our kind of operational expertise in terms of the way that we interact with the marketplace. And we sort of make it easier for clients. In the case of the PE1 trust, it's actually pretty unique. There, we had a desire to make that kind of like the building block of private equity for people, thinking it was going to be one of the few private equity exposures they're likely having in their portfolio. So we even there try to diversify by underlying exposure. So if you look at you look through that trust, there's 375 companies today, probably on its way to 500 to 600 companies, you know, as a good example. I think it'd be very difficult for kind of an underlying investor in the trust to ever do all the work that we're doing across all of those different investments, you know, at scale.
Well, we're seeing a lot of companies going private or choosing not to go private. I know, speaking here in Australia, we've had quite a few delistings already in Australia just in the first few months of this calendar year. What does the privatization trend actually do for your opportunity set?
The same phenomenon exists in the US, in Europe, in the rest of Asia as it does in Australia, which is there are fewer public firms over time, or fewer public firms kind of scale and relevance is probably the right way to think about it too. And like in the US, for example, if you went back 30 years, there were more than twice as many public companies as there are today. So the economy is much larger. There's far more companies, obviously, overall. And yet there are, you know, one in two has disappeared from the public markets over that period of time. And so, you know, the same phenomenon exists. It's what it's really done is it's caused an enormous growth in the total addressable market for a private equity firm or a private equity sponsor. So if you think about kind of not only did it grow because the economy grew and the share of companies that were private was already larger than the public markets, but then there was a mix shift of public to private at the same time, which meant that there was even more capital that had to flow into the private context. So that's all definitely true. The only challenge it sort of provides is one of the forms of exit for private equity, not necessarily even the most common one. The most common one is a strategic sale or a sale to other private equity sponsors, a much more common form of exit. But going public used to be a common form of exit for private equity firms. It's not as common anymore unless your firm has really grown in size and scale. So if you know you were kind of a $1 billion or $2 billion firm that grew to be a $25 billion firm, that can go public, that will go public. That's probably a level of efficiency where you'd want to be in the public markets. But a $2, $3 billion company, you're far more likely to sell it to another private equity sponsor, or sell it to a corporate or a strategic or another type of buyer than you are to go public. So, you know, it's kind of the mix. You gain more opportunities in terms of companies you can invest in, but you lost one of your avenues from exit for a certain size of company because of, you know, kind of some of the shifts that have happened in the marketplace.
So we're hearing a lot also, not just about the plans to go private, but also a lot about an economic downturn, the possibility of a US-led recession. How is your mix of investments changing as we see more talk of a global economic downturn?
We've been a little bit hesitant to take a lot of economic risk since, you know, kind of 2018, 2019. And if you go back and kind of look at that period, the reason why was interest rates were zero. The cost of funding that we were seeing in the businesses that we were able to buy was absurdly cheap. The terms on which that financing was provided were too loose. And it was a great time to be an equity holder, trying to sell a business, better than any time we had ever seen in the private equity kind of landscape. So, you know, we wanted to be net sellers, not net buyers. And we also were shifting our activity into, I'll call them economically resistant or recession resistant type businesses. So things that were either going to grow through a recession, so it wasn't going to matter, or the types of businesses that are likely to do okay. You know, think of like grocery as a good example. Like you just, even when you have recessions, people still consume, you know, kind of at the grocery store. It tends not to be the first purchase that they give up on, or things like defense contracting or government service provision, you know, certain programs that they grow 1-3% a year, kind of no matter what, what's going on kind of in the economy and the provision. So, you know, we shifted to those types of companies. That's definitely for sure. The real change though for us was just a much more conservative underwriting, you know, starting 4 or 5 years ago. It ended up serving us really well in COVID by accident, right? So if you were kind of conservative because you were worried about it being late cycle, you were worried about things like inflation, even though there was no inflation, you were worried about having pricing power in the businesses. It turned out that actually served you really well during COVID, and it served you really well coming out of COVID. So, you know, we were right, but for the wrong reason, if you know what I mean. Meaning we don't have predictive powers, but it ended up working. And then, you know, today you've seen an increase in interest rates. You've seen a pretty big change in the capital structures of these businesses. And I think that's likely to last, you know, meaning that is kind of structural and that's here to stay.
So you talk about this being a global private equity fund. How globally diverse is it?
The private equity market that we target, which you should think of as kind of the buyout market or the middle market buyout market, it's principally North America and Europe, right, is the right way to think about it. And we're very diverse across those two geographical footprints and by sector. And then also those companies are typically selling into the global marketplace. So, you know, kind of one of the unusual thing is the location of your headquarters is no longer a relevant factor in deciding what the economic risk of the business is, right? So, you know, you might say, well, Microsoft. And so you're like, well, Microsoft's obviously a US company. But Microsoft's not really a US company. Microsoft, most of its revenues are coming from somewhere else, right? And, you know, you think of the economic effects, private equity looks a lot like that today too. And so if you look through, it's really for us about diversifying the sources of revenue through different channels. And it's important to do because typically the whole world doesn't go into recession at the same time. And one of the ways that you can kind of insulate your private equity enterprise from downturns is by not being geographically concentrated, meaning we will pay and the market will pay a premium for private equity enterprises that have a more diverse revenue profile geographically and by type of customer.
And just finally, Fred, I know we've been talking a lot about the different entities you invest in and your team invests in. What are the characteristics of those great businesses that are worthy of your time and your investment?
Really, what you're looking for are companies that don't require enormous amounts of capital to operate, but have huge opportunities to invest additional capital at really high rates of return if you can. So meaning, you know, ideally, you're looking for returns on equity that are above the market return on equity, so 15% plus type return on equity. No need to put capital back into the business, but opportunities to put the capital back in the business at those rates of return. You want them to have pricing power so that if you do get inflationary environments, you can pass it through to the customers, and your cost structure is such that at a minimum, you can flex it with, you know, kind of price constraints to maintain the same margin on an inflation adjusted basis. Sometimes you get lucky and you actually have some operating leverage in that cost structure, you know, when there is an inflation environment, but you kind of want that as a minimum. You want a fantastic management team. So, you know, at the end of the day, the businesses over time will kind of find their weight. And the thing that they'll find their weight to is the management team. They'll make enough changes and enough kind of additions and subtractions from the business over time that, you know, it will really alter your economic path. Even if you bought a great business kind of cheap, if it has terrible management, you know, that will cause a problem. Likewise, kind of you won't be able to fix a bad business with good management. So it's like you need a combination of the two in terms of what's going on. Ideally, it would have a kind of a TAM or a total addressable market that gives the business runway where you could see real growth of, you know, 5 to 10% plus on a revenue basis for a very long period of time, because, you know, the market typically will never pay enough of a premium multiple for the business I'm describing, meaning like a lousy business will trade for 7 or 8 times EBITDA. A great business in the private equity space with all these characteristics will trade for like 12 to 14 times EBITDA. If they're really growing at 10% plus, have pricing power, have this return on equity and all these things, the math will tell you it should trade for a much bigger multiple, but it never really does. And so in a weird way, the valuation arb that's available in the marketplace is not what people think. It's not buying something really cheap. It's buying something that should be far more expensive at a fair price is the arb. And that's what you try and do in the private equity context.
Fred, it's been fantastic to chat. Thank you so much for joining us.
Great. Thank you very much for the time. Great questions.
And we thank you for joining us. We hope you enjoy the rest of the Livewire listed series, now available at livewiremarkets.com and marketindex.com.au. Thank you for joining us.